Well, a very good morning to you, very good people of the Falmouth area. How are you doing? Hope you're well. Thanks for joining me. How very considerate. How very kind of you. Well, I'm pleased you could be with us. Cornwall Science Sessions, as you just heard then, with me, Ben Makin. As always, though, we're going to branch out from science, okay? Pride ourselves on bringing you experts from all over the scene, all over the place, okay? Loads of different areas today. Branching out a little bit into fashion, all right? We're going to hear what's going on in the world of fashion. We've got Josh Newis-Smith. Now, Josh, fantastic chap. Just going to say that straight off, okay? He's the fashion celeb director at InStyle magazine and website. Now, he's a celeb interviewer as well, okay? So, fantastic to have him on the show. And he's talking to us a little bit about some research that's actually come out of Barclaycard, okay? Talking about the amount that's been spent on clothes recently. Now, here's the kicker, ladies and gents. It turns out, okay, gents, chaps, you know, own up, come on. We all like to spend a little bit extra on shirts, or so the research goes, okay? If you're guilty, don't worry about it, okay? Everyone's doing it, apparently so, anyway. So apparently men are actually spending more on clothes and beauty products than women are in recent months, okay? There you have it. We'll hear from Josh about that later on. We've also got Lizzie Carr. Now, Lizzie, very inspirational speaker, actually. So she actually survived cancer. So she went through the diagnosis, a terrible time for her. She survived cancer, came out the other end, and she completely turned it all around, okay? So she kind of took all that horrible, must have been a horrible period of anxiety, negativity, and she turned it all around, and now she's an eco-warrior, blogger, a speaker. Yeah, she's fantastic. We've got her on the show alongside the Director of Clinical Services over at Bupa, Dr. Petra Simic. So fantastic to hear from them both. Now, they're talking, actually, a little bit about a campaign that Bupa are putting forward at the moment, and this is about everyday moments. Everyday moments of life that people enjoy. And, you know, people enjoy thanks to their health. So really, they're just going to get a message out there that health is so important, and talking a little bit about, you know, the best way to go about basically making sure that you're looking after yourself on the health front. Now, if you yourself have struggled with any health issues, I'd actually really like to hear from you this morning, okay? So we've got, as I said, we've got Lizzie on, who has been through this, you know, terrible period of suffering from cancer. She's got the all clear. Came out the other end of it. So I'd really, really like to hear from you if you struggle, or perhaps you did struggle with particular health issues. I'd like to hear from you. Give me a text, 07860 670 917. That number again, 07860 670 917. Give me a text. Tell me a little bit about yourself, about your story. If you've got one to share, I'd like to hear from you. And let's hope we can kind of, you know, bring some kind of positives out of this, okay? You know, we can turn this around. It's about living in the moment, I suppose. And this is what this Bupa campaign was all about, hashtag everyday moments. Josh has got his own hashtag as well. You'll find out about that later. He might have invented him a cheeky hashtag. You'll find out in a bit, okay? Now, I know what you're thinking. Haven't heard from the cooking front in a while. Yeah, I know. As I said, you know, at the beginning of the show, experts from all over the place, okay? At the end of the day, I think that's what science is all about, getting experts from their relevant areas to come and talk to you. I'm also going to chat to you a little bit about, you know, some more sciencey stuff, but yeah, don't worry, not too heavy. I just came across, to me yesterday, actually, I was chatting to some really, really brilliant students, you know, real pleasure to chat to brilliant students. And it just suddenly occurred to me, I was telling them about this this hidden sense, actually, that humans have. Now, yeah, get excited, okay? This is cool stuff, right? I'm going to teach you your very own, should we call it a minor superpower? I mean, I suppose you could develop it, and then it'd be quite cool. Tell you all about that later. But it came to my attention, actually, that maybe you haven't heard about this. So I thought, well, yeah, good people of Falmouth, good people of Cornwall, yeah, deserve to hear about this. So I'm going to tell you about this. And this is all about perceiving an extra property of light in addition to colour. Okay, and intensity, of course. Yeah, cool, yeah? So I'll be telling you a little bit about that later. Anyway, what was I saying about the cooking? Yeah. So you were thinking, I really want to, you know, hear a bit more from cooking, because I know what an expert of cook Ben is. You know, actually, speaking of, you know, me being an expert cook, here's a little clip, actually. So I was cooking up some chili sauce. I had a couple of mates around. Sam was with me as well, actually. Govinda and Jared as well. They didn't think that I was doing a great job of this blender, right? It was giving me a right nightmare, okay? It just wasn't working. So I thought, well, all right, we'll just give it a helping hand. This is what happened anyway. So, you know, maybe I'll start with this. This is like the worst cooking attempt in history. And then, I'm going to follow it up with some celeb chefs. Yeah? That's right. Yeah, now you're excited. Now you're listening. Ooh. Ooh. Yeah. Okay, so stay tuned, yeah? So I'm going to give you this. It's going to be the worst cooking ever. And we're going to back it up by the best cooking ever straight after it, okay? Exciting, yeah? Ah, yeah, yeah. It's great. Anyway, okay, enjoy this. Just you know, listen to the expertise that's clearly going on here. Well, a very good morning to you. We're in the kitchen, actually. About to cook up some chilli sauce. This is a fantastic recipe. I urge you all to try it.
Right, he's now shoving a wooden spoon in a blender.
That is not safe.
If we lose an arm here.
Yeah, it didn't go too well, did it? Okay, anyway, let's move on very swiftly. Very swiftly indeed, shall we? All right. Oh, what am I talking about then? Who have I got on the show? Some celeb chefs, yeah, first? Well, all will be revealed right now. Enjoy.
Chaps, if I could just let you introduce yourselves very quickly, if that's okay, because I think, yeah, that's going to be pretty cool, because people are going to think, oh, yeah, he's got the fabulous Baker Bros on the show. Fantastic. So I'll just let you introduce yourself, if that's all right.
Yeah, sure. My name's Tom.
And I'm Henry, and we're the fabulous Baker Brothers.
Yep.
Awesome. Well, very warm welcome to you both, chaps. So I'm going to start, okay, with the big question. Obviously, based in Cornwall, this show, I'm going to have to lay it straight on you, I'm afraid. I'm so sorry for this, but I think we should start by just laying to rest this issue, right? Cream tea. What's the correct way of making it, guys? Cornish way or Devon way? What are you going to go with?
I like to do one side Cornish and one side Devon, and then it kind of keeps both camps happy.
I like to split the scone in half, go jam and jam on both, and then a huge bit of cream, and then sandwich it together.
Oh, that's genius! Yeah, it's like a sandwich. Then you can't argue which is on top of the other one. Perfect.
We're just wading into the Devon Cornwall debate and adding a kind of Gloucestershire, like, yeah. Oh, hold on a minute, how about us? Kind of way.
Yeah, exactly. It's not fair. It's not all about Cornwall and Devon, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Did you bend the scone? I don't know.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'm pleased we could address that issue straight on, so that's good.
Thank you. Well, glad to help.
Again, a very warm welcome to you both, both chaps.
Thanks, Ben.
So how's it going? What's going on in the world of the Fabulous Baker Bros at the moment? Anything exciting on the horizon?
Yeah,
well, we're sat at the WTM conference in Excel, which is basically it's the entire world comes to London to showcase their spaces. But we've been working with a villa resort in the Quinta do Lago, which is on the Algarve in Portugal. It's a beautiful villa resort called the Four Seasons Fairways. And we've been working with them to create a kind of winter grill campaign, which essentially it's to encourage people who are staying at the resort to get out into their gardens in the winter. Now, when we say winter in the Algarve in Portugal, it's not drizzling cold like UK. We're talking kind of 20 degrees, so it's still kind of shorts and t-shirts weather. Apparently the pool is just about the right temperature for a quick dip. And it's to encourage people to do some grilling. So we've created five really nice recipes using kind of local ingredients. So it's kind of like sea bass, it's nice local herbs. A particularly nice one with a local tipple called Madrono, which is a bit like a kind of English slow gin, but it's much stronger, way more medicinal, and will definitely warm your cockles on a cold day.
Yeah, we put that in with some figs and baked it, called them tipsy figs.
Yeah, it's pretty delicious.
Simple dessert that can be done on the grill.
Yeah, but they're just like simple recipes. The things that we like to cook for our families, and you know, when we're out on holiday, and just encourage people. But we've made videos so you can watch them, and there's little recipe cards.
They're on YouTube, so you can go for free. And if you really like the look of them, obviously you can try them wherever you are in the world. But in February, we're doing masterclass there. So if you're stuck for what to get for Christmas for your family, perhaps you could book it and come out to where it's sunny and warm, and we'll see you for some barbecuing in February.
Oh, now that
just as an idea.
Sounds awesome. Yeah, sounds great. Well, I mean, now, whilst we're on topic, chaps, have you got a link to hand? Of course, I can find this online, I'm sure, but have we got a website link we can send people to? I mean, they can check out YouTube, of course, as well.
Well, you can obviously Google it, but it's fourseasonsfairways.com/EN for English, I guess, slash winter grill. And you'll have all the details on there. So also just Google Fairways, Tom and Henry Herbert, Baker Brothers, you know, you'll find it easy enough.
Yeah.
It's all over it.
Fantastic.
But yeah, we got other stuff as well. Henry's got a couple of shops.
Yeah, so we've just opened up two bakeries in Bristol. So they're kind of bakery cafes.
Ideally, if you're heading from Cornwall, because we've got family down in Cornwall, so we come down a lot. And if you're heading back up north and need somewhere to stop off for breakfast or lunch en route.
Yeah, so you can pick up a loaf, have a coffee, take a cake, and also have some brunch, yeah. So they're really nice. So for me, the summer's felt a bit like having two new babies.
Yeah, fantastic.
And, so it's been quite full on, but it's been really good. And really happy.
Oh, well,
for my part, I've had my little baby is I've just got a book out called Do Wild Baking, which is a small kind of recipe book with some ideas and recipes of how to cook outside. So kind of campfire, barbecue, grilling, all this kind of stuff in a book.
Yeah, and the bonus is it's a small little book, so you can put it in your back pocket, so you don't have to, you know, if you're going out to do some bit of camping, it's not like lugging around an encyclopedia.
You can put it in your coat pocket. And if you don't like any of the recipes and you're stuck for some kindling or something to start your fire with, you could just, you know, put a couple of pages out.
No, not
got a sweet tooth, and don't fancy a banana loaf cake with chocolate in it. If that doesn't sound like your kind of thing, you know, you could use that. Yeah. And you're joking.
No one's going to be doing that. That would be outrageous. Well, this is fantastic. Yeah, I mean, congratulations, Henry, on your two. And Bristol's a lovely city as well. It's a fantastic place to have them. Yeah, and this book sounds awesome, Tom, as well.
Thanks, man.
I think, you know, I really in agreement here. I think people should just grill more often because I think it's, you know, people think it's only, you know, strictly a summertime activity. I'm going to own up, actually, guys. I recently bought a pizza oven and a smoker, and it is the best decision I've ever made.
Oh, absolutely.
It's awesome.
The thing is barbecuing, it's a form of cooking, and actually, if it's raining and cold outside, you can eat inside.
Yeah.
And actually, the flavour you get from doing it on the barbecue is, you know, you can't recreate that in your home. You have to do it outside. And, I'm a big fan, and particularly coming up to Christmas, you know, barbecuing a turkey makes a lot of sense.
Freed up
space in your oven, so you can get your roasters perfect, and your York is, you know, spot on. And actually, you know, the barbecue is the ideal place to cook your roast turkey.
But it's really tasty as well for the barbecue.
Yeah.
And also, you know, even in the UK, we do get rare, you know, it's not unheard of, is it, to have a really nice, sunny, wintry day?
Yeah, exactly.
And everyone gets a bit cabin feverish, you know, and a lot of people don't like January and February. Well, maybe, you know, we just need to be out more. Some people garden, other people go for long walks. I think it's just as legitimate to light up a fire, whether that be a campfire or your grill. And we've done plenty of recipes to help you on your way, make sure it's not a total disaster.
Fantastic. People should definitely check that out. I mean, especially being in Cornwall as well, I think this works really nicely for people because, I mean, you know, I can imagine people just being able to pop down to the beach if it's not terrible weather, get down to the beach, maybe take the book along, take a grill, and there you are, off you go.
Just for example, so I've got a recipe, the book's split into chapters, and one of them's beach, so beach kind of recipes.
Fantastic.
And the starter opening one is you get yourself a bag of mussels. I guess if you know where to look, you could get your own. And then you do a campfire using driftwood, which there always is driftwood on beaches
absolutely.
When you look. And then when it's burnt down to embers, you just stick the mussels into the embers. And then you lift them out using another mussel that's already been eaten and squeeze a bit of lemon over them. Yeah. And I swear, I've had loads of people that have eaten mussels all different ways. And they say they are, without a doubt, hands down, the best mussels they've ever tasted because you're just on the beach. You know, if it's a bit cold and wintry, it's just such a beautiful and lovely thing to do.
That is fantastic. Yeah, that sounds lovely. I think I actually came across a fantastic chap. I never met him before, but on the beach, it was at Helford River, a beautiful area in Cornwall. And there's a chap actually doing some wild cooking there. So it's a shame I didn't have your book, actually. I could have popped over and given him a hand.
Was it Ben Quinn from the Woodfired Canteen? He's down your way, and he does a lot of wood-fired cooking, and he's a great guy. I've met him a couple of times.
Yeah, okay. No,
you've got some good talent down there, haven't you? Whereabouts in Cornwall are you?
Yeah, so I'm personally based in Falmouth. Obviously Helford's not far away. A good spot. And even Padstow. And I know you're fans of Polzeath, aren't you? But that's not too far away. So it's a nice spot. Very nice spot.
We're down near Porthleven quite a bit as well.
Lovely.
Great for pasties, obviously.
Oh, yes.
Some good bakeries down your way too.
Yeah, absolutely. It's perfect, really. Lots of bakeries, lots of perfect spots for grilling as well, if people fancy doing that. Fantastic.
Get involved, people.
Yeah, exactly. So what was the book title again, Tom? Do Wild
Baking.
It's called
Do Wild Baking. It's part of the Do Book Publishing Company. They do these little manuals for things. Check them out. They're somewhere in Penzance that sells them. There's a little kind of independent bookshop. I'm afraid I can't remember the name of it.
Oh, we'll find that. Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah, and you can get it online, of course.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much. And Henry, your two new Bristol
restaurants. Yeah, Hobbs House Bakery. Yeah, come visit there. Their brand spanking.
He's there more than he wants than he should be. Because of staffing issues. No, he's all right. But he's there a lot, so come and see him.
Come say hello.
Fantastic.
Come try one of our pasties.
We cotta cream in ours. How about that? You can get away with that down in Cornwall, but I tell you, it's flipping good.
We just go for it, I think. You know, just go for it. Don't be shy, I think, people.
Why be shy? Yeah.
I'll pop in as long as you promise to throw in an autograph as well. Then I'll be fine.
Absolutely, yeah. Not worth anything, but we'll do it.
No, well, thank
cheers,
you very
Ben.
Much, guys. Really appreciate this. Thanks, chaps.
Thanks, Ben. Have a good day.
Cheers, you too.
Tom and Henry Herbert, a.k.a. the Fabulous Baker Brothers. Thank you very much to them for coming on the show to chat to us all about their, well, the exciting stuff that they're currently up to. So if you missed that, then, of course, do get involved. Search for Fairways. If you fancy a bit of grilling in Feb, barbecue grilling in Feb, then you can check them out. Google Fairways with Tom and Henry Herbert. You'll find them, the Fabulous Baker Bros. That book, Do Wild Baking, sounds pretty cool to me. I can think of actually plenty of beaches where I would fancy cracking out the grill. You know, guys, this is what we got. You know, okay, we're in Cornwall, yeah? Grilling. Here's the secret. Grilling, or so I'm told. Grilling is not just for summer. Barbecue grilling. Yeah? It's for winter as well. It's for every time, yeah? Just take a shelter from the elements. You know, you can still do a bit of cooking. But on a more serious note, that does sound like a really cool book. Just fancy that. Just getting a fire out on the beach. Grilling your own muscles. Oh, yeah. Cheeky, really cheeky. Well, thank you very much, Tom and Henry. Absolutely fantastic to chat to you both. Now, coming up on the show, as promised, we've got Josh Newis-Smith chatting about fashion, what's going on with fashion and spending. Now, let's get involved with this debate, okay? He's gonna bring up a little we made a bit of an informal competition, okay? We'll chat about it a bit later, yeah? So just be thinking about that, okay? And be ready to text in, because I want to hear from you about that bit, okay? So, pay attention. Pay attention, please. Next up then, I'm going to have Lizzie Carr on the show alongside Dr. Petra Simic. Dr. Simic is GP and the Clinical Director of Clinical Services at Bupa. And Lizzie Carr, as I said, been through cancer survivor, some horrible time for her. She's come out the other end. She's now a record breaker, an adventurer, a blogger, eco-warrior. Fantastic, basically. Now, I'm going to play you a song first. Now, this is... I was trying to think of a song suitable for the Fabulous Baker Bros. I immediately thought of Rod Stewart, because Rod Stewart is the greatest singer on earth. I am going to get some Rod Stewart on the show later. In fact, shout out to Sam Barton. I imagine he's, probably just about to arrive in the lab. Okay, Sam, fellow scientist. He sent me an absolute cracking tune last night. This Old Heart of Mine. Now, this is a 1989 version. Oh, yeah, it's good. So I'm going to get that on the show, and I'll probably dedicate that to you, Sam, obviously, for sending that in, but also to the Fabulous Baker Bros. Okay, so that's coming up. That's the theme tune. Okay, that's the Fabulous Baker Bros theme tune, maybe. Or actually, no, probably it's Do You Think I'm Sexy? The answer's yes. Maybe I'll just amend the title a bit there. Let's leave that for later, okay, because, we can't get... You can't have things getting too hot and steamy quite yet. Yeah, it's not even 8 o'clock, so let's keep it chilled for a minute. And let's go with some of this, actually. Some Joe Nichols. Now, Joe Nichols, if you're a fan of country music, Brad Paisley, actually, has been in the news recently for a couple of concerts he's been doing. It's actually on Netflix now as well, Brad Paisley. So I think he's starting to become quite well-known here in the UK. So obviously a massive artist in the States. But, people are starting to take note of what he's doing. Great artist. A whole bunch of fantastic country musicians, I guess. Probably all heard of Tim McGraw. If you're a fan of Tim McGraw, actually, listen to our music special. Yeah, a few weeks ago, because that was pretty cool. He spoke about Tim McGraw there, actually, with the Lieutenant Governor of Louisiana. Louisiana is actually where from Tim McGraw's from, so that was pretty cool. So yeah, check that out on the catch up. Yeah, Source FM catch up. If you fancy listening to that, it's just what happens. Yeah, just a constant adverts for our own show. Yeah, I'm not gonna try not to do that anymore. I'm sorry. I apologise. No more of that. Let's get some Joe Nichols on. So this is a fantastic tune. Quite a slightly old tune now. Man with a Memory. It's really, 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 really nice. You know what? I think there's some kind of... The guitar in this, kind of Knopfler style, kind of Mark Knopfler style, Dire Straits, I think. I think you're going to like this anyway. I'm going to give this a spin for you. Now, enjoy.
Johnny's got a heart of gold. Ask anyone around here. But some nights his eyes are far away and filled with tears. Sweet Mary Lou's just as good as they come, with a weakness for all the wrong men. From the look on her face tonight, she's been wrong again. Bartender's thinking to himself as he rubs his towel around a glass. Now there's a man with a memory, here's a woman with a past. Lost souls on life's highway, forever looking back. When you're living for the love, and the love doesn't last, you get a man. Bartender turns the TV down, cranks that old jukebox up, carefully selects which buttons to push for what each song does. A C-23 after J-19, it's a tonic for a broken heart. A little stardust in the mix, it's a fine, fine art. Dim the lights a notch or two, the next round is on the house. For the man with a memory and the woman with a past. Lost souls on life's highway, forever looking back. When you're living for the love, and the love doesn't last, you get a man with a memory, a woman with a past. Oh, we've all got something we've got to get around. Now and then you get the chance to help the lost get found. Stacking chairs and sweeping up, he can't help a little smile, thinking about the man with a memory and the woman with a past. Lost souls on life's highway, forever looking back. When you're living for the love, love doesn't last, get a man with a memory, a woman with a past. You get a man with a memory, a woman with a past.
Lovely tune. Man with a Memory, Joe Nichols. Yeah, check out more Joe Nichols if you haven't come across him before. Yeah, I urge you to, okay? Get stuck. This is what you have to do, and this is
this is just the greatest moments, I think. Okay, some of the greatest moments when you get lost in the YouTube on a YouTube playlist. Okay, and you come across a new fantastic artist. That's the best feeling, finding a brand new artist that you're a big fan of. Joe Nichols, yeah, one of those. Check him out. Absolutely. Honestly, you won't be disappointed. Yeah, it's happened again, guys. I've got a text from Steph. Apparently, it's 45 days till Christmas. Now, yeah, in case you wanted to know. Vital information this morning for you, I'm sure. Maybe probably wasn't as enthusiastic as she was hoping I would make that. Okay, shall I chuck in a noise to make it more enthusiastic? Okay, 45 days till Christmas, guys, yeah. Woo! Actually, on the Christmas front, I know it's a bit early, but we're actually going to have our very own Christmas song to play for you, okay, with an awesome story behind it. Money actually being raised by this song for charity, so this is awesome. We're going to play this. We're going to play it every show leading up to Christmas, starting soon, okay? So listen out for that. So actually, Steph, well done. You reminded me of a fantastic, fantastic point to make to you. Right, okay, anyway, as promised, I'm going to now introduce you to Lizzie Carr, the cancer survivor, record holder and adventurer, as I've been talking about before, alongside Dr. Petra Simic, the GP and the clinical director over at Bupa. So here they are right now. Enjoy this chat with them.
I'm Lizzie Carr, and I am an adventurer, blogger and environmentalist. And I'm Dr. Petra Simic. I'm a GP and I'm a clinical director at Bupa.
Fantastic. Well, a very, very warm welcome to both of you. Thank you very much for joining me this morning. And I'd really like to talk about this survey, actually, that's just been put out there by Bupa, looking at people's attitudes to health in their kind of everyday lives. Because it seems to be, actually, isn't it, that you've actually found that actually quite a lot of people don't seem to really take health so seriously unless there's a major problem. So I don't know whether you could kind of just very quickly, I'll start with you if this is okay, Dr. Simic, if you could, you know, maybe just give us a little outline for us and maybe tell us a little bit about your reaction to it as well.
Yeah, this research was really interesting. We asked 4,000 people about their attitudes to everyday activities, life, and health. And the two main things came out of this, as far as I'm concerned. Firstly, what we discovered is people see health in a very black and white way. Two-thirds of the people surveyed felt that good health meant a lack of life-threatening illness, which is very surprising because as a GP, I spend most of my time dealing with all of the shades of grey in between.
Yes.
I particularly see that at Bupa. We do health assessments, which can involve up to an hour with a GP. And although people often come having said, oh, I've got no health concerns, I just want a health MOT, we spend much of the hour talking about various niggles and aches and pains and mild symptoms that they haven't felt important enough to get professional advice about before. And we find that working with them, we can often improve those symptoms and improve their quality of life. The second thing that I think this research shows is that when we ask people what they would miss if they could no longer do, it was the everyday things, those everyday moments that they would miss most, whether it be socialising with friends or family, or washing comfortably, or driving. And we know that those things make people happy. So there's definitely a disconnect, and people haven't realised that good health equals happiness.
Yes, that's a really nice point, actually. And this is a fantastic campaign, this everyday moments thing. Lots of people have been getting involved with the hashtag everyday moments, you know, just sharing really what they enjoy doing. And of course, you know, you're saying here that you know, health problems can, of course, get in the way of that. What do you, in kind of an ideal world, what would you, you know, advise people to do? You know, perhaps they're not taking health too seriously, but at the same time, it sounds like, you know, they could very well have these kind of, in their minds, minor problems. What would you kind of urge them to do?
Well, I think I'd ask them to stop and take stock. Think about what feels good and appreciate that, hence the hashtag Everyday Moments campaign, but also recognise what doesn't feel good or what's stopping them from doing things they enjoy. And when they've done that, then they then need to be kind and invest in themselves. We don't think anything about it, or we consider investing in things like our cars or our homes is a normal, responsible thing to do. If our car starts making a funny noise, we'll take it to the mechanic and get it fixed. We need to give the same attention to our bodies. And if something doesn't feel right, go and speak to a professional about it, whether that be a physio for aches or pains, a pharmacist, or even a GP. We provide GP appointments up and down the country for people who want to choose the time, location, and duration of their appointment. Getting the things checked when they're a problem can really help them from progressing into something more serious.
Ah, fantastic advice. And Dr. Simica, where can people kind of look for, I don't know if they can look somewhere to find out a bit more about this, and certainly, of course, if they were worried about something, of course, they could visit you at Bupa.
Yep, so all of our clinic locations and services, health assessments and pay-as-you-go GP services, all the information on that is on www.bupa.co.uk. And for anyone that wants to celebrate their everyday moments, we're running a social media conversation, hashtag everyday moments.
Fantastic. And this is a really, really nice way of kind of addressing this, I think, as well, you know, to get people just to start talking about what they are enjoying in their everyday lives. Because, I mean, you know, this is, you know, coming up with things like driving and even taking a shower and a bath and things, isn't it? And, you know, socialising with friends and family. And, you know, it's all things like this, which are obviously, I'm sure everybody can imagine those being very important.
Absolutely. Interestingly, driving didn't surprise me. It was in the top three. I'd say some of my most difficult consultations with patients are the ones that end in me saying, and this condition means you cannot drive for some amount of time, whether it be a short amount of time because they've got problems with their neck and they can't see their blind spot, or whether they've had a seizure, which means they may not be able to drive for up to a year. Often the thing that upsets them most is my advice about driving, not the potential diagnosis of epilepsy.
Yes, and that's quite astonishing, really. But I guess it's, you know, I don't know whether you might sort of attribute some of that to, you know, current very busy lifestyles and, you know, time spent getting to jobs and things. I mean, these all seem like things which are, you know, necessary to basically carry on with a busy lifestyle.
Oh, absolutely. I think they all feel essential, and people feel that that's more important than their general health.
Well, thank you very much for your time, Dr. Zimick. I'd really like to turn to you now, Lizzie, and chat a little bit about your blog, because I must say it's absolutely fantastic. But maybe you could actually just take us on a little journey about, you know, maybe how it kind of came into being in the first place, this fantastic blog, Lizzie Outside.
So I was diagnosed with cancer about 5 years ago in my mid-20s. And obviously, at the time, it was very unexpected. It was an experience that completely blindsided me. And I suppose it forced me to reevaluate and rethink the life that I was living, what that looked like and what that meant to me, and create a new life for myself that, I suppose, resonated more with my values.
Yes.
Cancer was a very difficult experience to go through, but it has been the catalyst to where I am now and the life that I now live, and, you know, doing my blog and my environmental campaigning and my challenges and the life I live now. I'm much more fulfilled by it and I'm much happier for it.
And this is fantastic. I mean, it sounds to me like you really, you know, converted all that. I thought there was an awful lot of anxiety going through that very difficult time for you, but it really sounds like you've turned that and actually turned to something really positive, because, you know, you mentioned the environmental work. So I've just seen actually you've been doing some work on plastic pollution, of course, which is a major up and coming environmental issue. So that's fantastic.
Yeah.
And getting people involved with that as well, haven't you?
Yeah. So I actually started paddleboarding as a direct result of my cancer diagnosis. For me, it was a low impact way of sort of restoring my health and fitness and sort of regaining my strength again. But there were these huge, like, psychological benefits to it as well that I really didn't expect. And I sort of started paddling around the canals and rivers in London, and that's when I first saw the problem that we were facing with plastic pollution, which then really resulted in a complete overhaul of my life and sort of dedicating myself to something very different to what I'd ever expected it to be.
Yes, absolutely. And I mean, on the paddleboarding front, of course, we do have a champion, because you're the first, I believe, do correct me please if I'm wrong, but I believe you're the first solo female to paddleboard across the English Channel back in May.
That is correct, yeah.
That's pretty awesome achievement. Also, of course, in your travelling, I picked up on this actually, because I've also been to Africa, and I must say it is quite a humbling experience, but I believe that you also, you know, really enjoyed seeing the rhinos and things like that.
Yeah, I'm a massive rhino advocate. I think at the moment we've got this huge problem with poaching, and it's something that I care deeply about and, you know, try and campaign for as well. There's lots of ways, I suppose, my illness has helped me grow as an individual, but most importantly, it's it's those everyday things that I really look at now and appreciate.
Yes.
My friends, my family, the ability to go outside and go for a run, to go on my paddleboard,
yes,
even, you know, just to have a conversation. These are such important moments in our everyday that make up our entire lives. And for me, I just try and remind myself how important they are and how grateful I am to, yes, to have them.
One of the major messages, perhaps, that's coming out of chatting to you both just this morning is that really, you know, if everybody were to just, you know, look after themselves, take their health seriously, and actually just, you know, enjoy life and you know, put really positive things out there. You know, for example, you know, all your environmental work. I mean, you know, and this is all thanks to, you know, being able to do that in the first place, isn't it?
Definitely. I think people really need to take stock of their lives,
yes,
before it's a problem. Just being mindful and preemptive and just taking control a little bit more, being more health aware, I think it's absolutely crucial, and not enough people do it. Everyone waits until it's too late. It shouldn't take really a brush with death to get people, yes, thinking about their lives and what's important.
Yes. Well, thank you very much to both of you for chatting to me this morning.
Thank you. Bye.
Hear the drums echoing tonight, and she hears only whispers of some quiet conversation. She's coming in 12:30 flight. The moonlit wings reflect the stars that guide me towards salvation. I stopped an old man along the way, hoping to find some old forgotten words or ancient melodies. He turned to me as if to say, "Hurry, boy, it's waiting there for you. Longing for some solitary company. I know that I must do what's right, sure as Kilimanjaro rises like Olympus above the Serengeti. I seek to cure what's deep inside, frightened of this thing that I've become.
Well, thank you very much, Lizzie. And thank you very much as well, Dr. Petra Simic. Fantastic to have you both on the show. And what a great song. Yeah, I chatted a little bit about Africa there, so kind of relevant, I thought. So, you know, any excuse to get that old classic on, hey? Yeah, I know. Okay, right, let's get on with the show then. So up next then, got this interview that I've been promising you with Josh Newis-Smith, all about fashion and spending. But first, because, you know, there was another promise that I made to you. And this promise just simply can't be broken. And this was me telling you about this extra sense which humans have, okay? Yeah, no, I'm being serious. This is real. Okay, so, okay, tell you what. Do this along with me, if you can. Obviously, this might be a bit tough if you're driving. So maybe do it later if you're driving. Okay, all you need for this to work really well. Laptop is ideal. Phone screen is kind of good. Laptop's the best thing to do. So if you've got a laptop or a computer screen, all you need to do is just bring up a completely blank white screen. So however you want to do that. So just make a Word document, make a PowerPoint, make a white slide. You know, however you just get a completely blank white screen. And you want the brightness up. If you've got a laptop, obviously, and the brightness is turned down low, turn it up. Okay, so all you've got is this bright white screen in front of you. Now, just to give you a bit of a backstory first, you know, whilst I'm explaining this, then hopefully you can set up the laptop if you've got one available. Okay, so the story goes like this, okay. So, researchers are confused by this behaviour in ants for quite a long time. So, to set the scene, we're in the Sahara Desert. Yeah, we're feeling quite warm, actually. You know, a bit, you know, not very nice, actually. Luckily, we've got some water, so take a sip. Yeah, we're feeling okay again now. Let's have a look around us. We look at these ants. There's these ants walking along this sand. And of course, in this ultra barren landscape, and these ants are really minuscule compared to the vastness of the desert. And they're all walking around. They, you know, they leave the nest and they go around in search of food. Yeah, you know, take this curved pathway, you know, just looking around, find some food. Okay, yeah, nothing unusual yet, kind of standard. But then, here's the thing. How do they find their way back to the nest? You know, they can leave a significant distance, away from the nest. How do they get back there? And it seems that they can form a perfectly straight line, straight back to the nest. Now, this was really weird at the time, because researchers were thinking, how on earth are they doing this? You know, there's no features in the desert that they can rely on. You know, they can't just rely on a simple tree. Like, well, okay, I made the nest by this tree or by this large rock, so I'll just return to that. You know, what about in a completely barren stretch of desert? That doesn't really work. So how are they doing this? You know, they walk, you know, away in these really curved pathways, and then somehow they just turn around, you know, point straight back to the nest and walk back to the nest directly in a straight line. Ultra efficient. And they thought, this is weird. How on earth are they doing this in the desert? And it turns out, actually, that a great number of different organisms, different animals, actually have this. And it's called a sun compass. I know this sounds a bit like it's made up, but it's a real part of actually some cognitive processes that animals have. You know, this is it came from a fantastic, first heard of this actually, a fantastic module that I did called comparative cognition, which is basically like almost like a psychology for animals. So it's almost like understanding the cognitive processes of animals, understanding you know, what they're capable of thinking about, you know, if anything, you know, on a more general level, what they're capable of doing thanks to neuronal activity, you know, complex neuronal activity. Yeah. So this sun compass. So what do I mean by this? Well, the ants are relying on a property of the sky, basically this pattern that's produced naturally every day by the sun, and this is a pattern of polarized light. Now, if you've done a bit of physics, maybe back in the school days, or if you're a student and you're doing physics, maybe you've heard about this polarization of light. But essentially, if you imagine light, of course, as a wave. Now, if you just imagine this is quite a crude explanation, so please excuse it. But if you imagine light traveling like a wave through space, okay. You know, a bit like a wave traveling through water, almost. If you imagine this wave, it's different in that this wave is actually transverse, which means that things, basically anything caught within this wave, is vibrating perpendicular to the direction of travel, of the wave front travel, if you like. So, yeah, basically, if you want to imagine this, just slowly extend your arm, and at the same time, move your arm up and down. Okay, that's the wave pattern as it goes forwards, okay? So the wave is moving forwards, but the direction of vibration is perpendicular, up and down, basically. Now, this direction of vibration is the key thing, right? Because this can happen in any number of directions, okay?
So, you know, you can have up and down, left to right, you know, at an angle, another angle, you know, and so on and so on and so on. And that is basically called the polarization of that ray of light. That source of light has a particular number of directions in which it's vibrating in like that. And you can change this, you know, certain things in nature change this, you know, they change the number of allowed directions of vibrations, if that makes sense. So reflection is a, you know, quite straightforward and kind of, you know, obvious one really that causes this polarization change. So, you know, if you imagine light from the sun, you know, totally unpolarized, you know, it's just vibrating in all kinds of different directions. Passes a, you know, hits these molecules, bounces off, and now at particular angles, if you were looking at this molecule which is bouncing all these waves off it, you would see only waves vibrating in one direction, you know, relative to the way that they're traveling. Okay, now I hope this makes sense, but basically all I'm trying to say to you is that there's this property of light called polarization. Okay, and it's this actually that the ants are using. So in the daytime sky, because of the arrangement of atoms in the atmosphere, and because of the sun's rays constantly reflecting off all of these molecules in the atmosphere, of course this means that there's always a pattern of polarization in the sky. So humans can't see this, or can they? Well, actually, we'll think about this in a minute. Let's go back to the ants just for a second. So hopefully you've nearly got your laptop set up if you do have one available, or yeah, just keep this in mind for later. So this is what the ants are doing. So basically, the ants' brains. Now this is a really cool bit actually. So the ants' brains basically have a map of a polarized light pattern. You know what polarized light might do. It's like a relative pattern, and it's basically like a map saved in the neurons in their brain. So it is literally like a kind of hardwired pattern that it has there, saved in its neuronal structure. And what it knows, this ant knows, because of the light that it's receiving in its eyes, it knows when it's moved, when it's turned relative to, because of course it has this pattern saved in its brain, if you like. So it knows when it's moved relative to the pattern that's in the sky. So this basically means that it kind of functions like a compass. This is where this sun compass thing comes in. It's actually, you know, a particular type of sun compass. This relies on polarized light, and it works because, simply enough, the ant knows automatically. You know, this is kind of happening unconsciously, or so we think. You know, the ant remembers exactly what the angle it's turned, and also how long it's been walking at this particular angle has been relative to its original direction, because of the number of steps it's taken. This is actually called dead reckoning. It's actually, very similar indeed to the way that ships would classically navigate, you know, based on compasses and knowing how long they're travelling in a particular direction for. And here's the even cooler bit, actually. So at the end of all of this, the ants walking out the nest, going in this curved pathway, and all the time, you know, every moment, unconsciously, it knows exactly which angle it's been going in because of its compass, this inbuilt sun compass, and it knows how long it's been walking for because of the number of steps it's taken. Therefore, it can calculate, actually, and this isn't like an automatic algorithm which takes place in the ant's brain, and it can back calculate the kind of sum vector, so the sum direction that's the complete opposite of the direction that it's been going in, the average direction, if you like. And of course, if it works this out and it takes this vector, then of course it will arrive straight back at the nest, because it's a straight line, basically, directly in opposition to the sum of the direction it's been going in. In other words, it leads straight back to the nest. Clever, huh? So this polarized light, humans can't see it. Or can they? Actually, we can. Now, here's the cool bit. Here's your hidden sense. You can see polarized light. So this isn't colour. This isn't colour. Okay, this isn't just an extra colour. It's almost like imagining you can see an extra colour, but it isn't that. It's actually a completely separate property to light. Here's your minor superpower. You can develop this. You know, you could learn to have your own sun compass like ants do. How cool would that be? Come on. Be able to navigate using polarised light. Okay, here's what to do. So if you've got a white screen in front of you, try this later if you can't try it now. All you need to do is stare at any point on this screen and tilt your head from side to side. Yeah? Side to side meaning, just go for it. Don't worry about looking silly. Look, I'm doing it now as well. Okay, so we're all doing it together. I'm going to do it on the studio screen, actually. Yeah, it's working for me. Okay, so tilt your head from side to side. And what you might be able to see is, it doesn't matter where you're looking, but anywhere on the white screen, you might suddenly notice, it looks like there's a bit of a smudge on the screen.
And if you keep vibrating, turning your head back and forth, what you might notice is that this pattern is shifting. And actually, if you Google this pattern, you'll see the kind of thing which you're going to look for. It's very faint, but it almost looks a bit like a yellow bow tie structure. Okay, very faint. When your head is tilting from side to side, this pattern is actually moving. It's twisting as well. So this is basically, if you can see this, you can kind of imagine how the ants are automatically doing this, right? Because as you move direction, almost, let's say, as you tilt your head, you can see that this thing is rotating a bit like a compass, a bit like the needle on a compass, a pointer on a compass. So yeah, I mean, you can probably kind of imagine how that works. Of course, this is all because of just a quirk of the structure of the eye, that we can see this, the macula, the most light sensitive region. Where most of the light sensitive cells are in the eye, actually, just because of a bizarre quirk of the structure of the particular arrangement of chemicals in there, the eyes are actually sensitive to polarized light, and what this results in is just this color basically in our field of view, and basically it gets perceived as this yellow color, this yellow bow tie, actually at a right angle with a blue bow tie. But I haven't managed to see the blue bow tie, I'm afraid. I'm not an expert yet. Haven't developed my sun compass. But try it. See if you can see this yellow bow tie. It should be rotating a little bit as you tilt your head back and forth from side to side, just staring at the white screen. So give it a try. I tell you what, if you manage it, text me. I'd love to hear from you. Text me on 07860-670-917 if you get that to work, okay? This will be your reward. You get to celebrate by listening to this. Superpower achieved. Achievement unlocked, isn't it? Polarized light vision. Okay, well, there you have it. Anyway, thought I'd tell you about that. You know, as I said, I was chatting to these fantastic students yesterday. Always love chatting to students. It suddenly occurred to me, actually, hang on, you know who I haven't told this to? The good people of the Falmouth and Penryn area. So there you have it, folks. Yeah, enjoy. Right then, let's move on with the show then. One more interview coming for you now. And as always, don't worry, because that isn't it. Got some tunes. I promised you a bit of Rod Stewart at the beginning of the show. And I will follow through with that promise. I said, we have to have a good theme tune for the fabulous Baker Bros. Extremely handsome men, So, of course, we're going to play some Rod Stewart. Sam Barton, this will go out to you as well. Thanks for sending them in. You sent me this absolutely cracking track. I'm going to play it in a bit. Of course, a bit of the old Rod. You got to love Rod. Especially pre-9am, I've heard. Anyway, okay, let's get this interview on with Josh Newis-Smith, all about fashion and spending. Now, listen close, okay, because I propose a competition. I propose one, okay, and you're going to challenge your partner. You're going to challenge your partner to this competition. Maybe I'm going to get hold of some prizes. Get involved with this, yeah. Text in, maybe later today. I'll tell you about the competition, yeah. I'm going to get hold of some prizes for you if you text in. I think that's only fair, isn't it? Right, okay, anyway, enjoy this. This is Josh Newis-Smith. He's a fantastic chap, actually. He's the celeb director, InStyle. Website, you can check it out online, InStyle. Fashion expert, celeb interviewer, cool guy. Anyway, here he is.
I'm Josh Newis-Smith, and I'm the fashion and celebrity director at InStyle UK. I'm a TV presenter.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much indeed, Josh. A pleasure to have you today. Yeah, I mean, this is actually, there's some quite entertaining stats actually here in this survey. We'll get to those. Let's just kind of outline the scene then. So we're talking about Barclaycard and their new research revealing that men are spending actually more money each month on clothes and shoes than women are, which is coming as a bit of a surprise, isn't it? I wonder if you could just outline this for us a little bit and tell us what your immediate thoughts on it were.
So Barclaycard have done this survey, which for some people I think they will find it quite surprising that men are spending more money on clothes and shoes and beauty products than women are.
Yes.
So men are now actually spending £300 more each year on these things than women. And when you break it down and you look at all these great facts and figures that are actually available on Barclaycard.com right now, you can check it out. And it basically, they're spending like £67 on clothes a month, which is more than they're spending on drinking with their friends and also like tickets for like match days and those kind of things. And then, but also, that's not necessarily that surprising to me. I kind of feel that men now are consuming fashion in ways they weren't before, and I also feel they tend to have a little bit more of an expensive taste when it comes to picking out staple items that they will spend that little extra bit of money on, yeah. Because they become those things in their wardrobe that they use time and time and time and time again. Whereas girls sometimes tend to be a bit more pro buying things and wearing them once, like this fast fashion trend that's taken over the fashion industry and completely changed it. But the one thing I find surprising about this research is that 9% of the people interviewed would prefer to clean the toilet than they would actually go into a shop. But then I think that whole like grumpy man syndrome of having to deal with crowds and queues kicks in, and that's why they hate going to shops. So what they are doing is they're spending their money online because they feel that's a safe space for them. And also what they're not doing is returning the items they're buying. So the idea of going to the stores petrifies them so much. They're like, no way am I going back in there. I'd rather just keep it and waste my money. So no wonder why they're racking up quite the sizable clothing costs.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting. I don't know whether... I know nothing on the topic. I'm going to own up straight away. But, has there been an increase in advertising towards men? I mean, has it always been the case that men have been likely to spend more? And you're saying, men tend to pick, perhaps spend a bit more on individual items, whereas, girls might be more likely to buy items for use once. Has it always been that way? Or has there been an increase in advertising towards men? Or has it always kind of been like this? Or
I don't think it's necessarily been an increase in advertising. I think that social media has had a massive effect on the way that everyone consumes everything. And I think men now will scroll through their phones as if they would look at the morning newspapers, where they would find those advertisements that were like for like a shaving gel or whatever, which was positioned and directed straight at them. Yes. Now they're literally just surrounded by hashtag goals wherever they turn, whether it be like, here's your body goal, here's your fashion goal, here's your beauty goal, here's your hair goal, and then they become so consumed with looking in a certain way, and then all they can do is basically just like throw the money at it and hope for the best. And I think that's when you look at these stats, when they're spending, this is the thing I find the most surprising about the stats, actually, is they're spending apparently on average £40.90, a crucial 90 pence there, on beauty and grooming products in comparison to £35.30 for women. So I think it's having a massive effect, and I think men now are much more open to talking about their grooming regime, so that because they're kind of proud of it, and it's kind of like a badge of honor. They're like, yeah, I pluck my eyebrows, and what? Because they see people on TV on these reality shows. I sound like my grandma. These reality shows are so bad for everyone. But these reality shows are saying to men, there's images of Love Island people getting ready where they're like shaving off all their body hair and they're putting blusher on for the live elimination shows, and because they are that image obsessed, and they feel like it's, and then men, the trickle down effect is men feel it's okay to do these things and spend the money on it. And I don't think they see grooming in particular, which is the crucial thing here, being a gendered pursuit anymore. It's more for everyone.
Yes. Oh, that's a really nice point, actually. And I hadn't really thought about that, but yeah, I mean, I guess it always kind of was in the past, wrongly, always seen as a thing only for women, but it's good that it's changed, basically.
Yeah, and I think also when you look back at it, like if you remember, like 15 years ago when I first was like, oh my god, I want to work in fashion, like that silly idea that popped into my head. here I am today. They basically, the metrosexual was a big buzz term, and everyone used to talk about metrosexuals all the time. And now when you think about it, you're like, that is such an old school term. Now everyone is just consuming fashion and the fashion media in ways they weren't before. They just can't escape it. And then when we're thinking of metrosexuals, you've got David Beckham, who's kind of the eternal style icon and was like the king of the metrosexuals at the time. And now he's still, according to the survey, one of the top style icons of the moment at age 42. And he sits alongside Tom Cruise, who's 55, and George Clooney, who's 56. And I think it actually just goes to show that there's a lot more confidence as you get older in your style and the way you dress, and that desire to be who you are and not really care. Like, and just be like, yeah, I look great, here I am, and I do spend X amount of money on these products.
Yes, yeah, exactly. It's actually quite encouraging, I think, that everybody everybody feels, you know, feels able to do that, because, you know, why not, basically. I mean, I'm quite a fan of picking up the occasional nice shirt, I'm going to admit that, but I think I only tend to go to the shop, actually, quite well. The good thing for me, actually, I go to Padstow quite often, which is a beautiful town in Cornwall, not sure if you've ever been, but there's a crew shop there, sometimes go in there, but that's about the only one that I'm going to brave, because it's nice and small, and there's no queues.
Oh, well, exactly, so you're one of these guys on the survey, right?
I think I can imagine myself falling in there.
Yeah, exactly. You're one of the old mowed the lawn, that's another one they would rather do, and they're two things I would never want to do ever, so
no.
I definitely would prefer to go shopping than that.
Yeah, I think I would draw the line at mowing the lawn. I think that's one of the worst jobs I can imagine. I'm supposed to have done that today, actually. I haven't got round to it. Maybe I'll go shopping instead.
Yeah, maybe you will.
Yeah, maybe.
You'll be encouraged by these findings.
And Josh, as well, because I assume, you know, with this kind of, you know, Barclaycard, obviously aware of this, you know, this survey coming from them on all these facts and figures, I don't know how this is kind of impacting, you know, I assume kind of, you know, vendors and merchants are also kind of jumping on board with this rise of, you know, social media thing and getting it across to men that way, you know, via Instagram and things like that. I assume they're doing a lot more of this now as well, would you think?
I think in general, yeah, totally. And I think also the way that people advertise coming from a magazine is completely changed.
Yes.
Now, when you're working in this, when you're working on publications, for instance, I think sometimes you won't necessarily put your advertisements in a magazine in the same way as you used to. Instead, you'll be like, right, I've got this budget. How am I going to spend it? And with Instagram, you can very much direct your advertisements at a certain demographic.
Yes.
So, you know, like when you go through the Instagram feeds now, there's advertisements pop up, and they are got stuff to do with things you've been talking on WhatsApp with your friends. Like, that's literally how they're doing it, and they know that you're this certain type of person. And so, for instance, if I was massively into fitness, they would put a protein shake advertisement up there, because they
yes.
know from the profiles I follow. And then also, when you have like influencers and bloggers, you pay them to do posts, and then so you'll have so and so wearing, I don't know, something from one high street brand, and then they will have a direct link to it, and they can tell how many shoppers have got to that product from that influencer, and then
yeah.
that makes that influencer more powerful. I just think that media is changing in such a drastic way, in a way that no one ever really anticipated. And I think it's actually taken a while for brands to catch up.
Yes.
Now they're very much like social media, social media, social media, social media, social media. Like, people have like social media marketing managers now. They have like people who just literally their whole jobs are finding these influencers and finding the right people and getting that product in the right hands.
Yes. I guess it makes perfect sense, because, you know, if you have this kind of instant access to trends and things, that's totally different, isn't it, to what it would have been, as you were saying, you know, magazine. Obviously, magazines only come out at certain times, right? So you have to
yeah.
wait by definition.
Yeah, and I think also the fashion industry has changed so much. In when you look at from right at the top, you have Burberry and Tommy Hilfiger, who have See Now, Buy Now, Collect. So what you see on the runway, you can buy immediately in stores, and it's readily available. You can go online and you buy it. Like, people have become so impatient. They don't want to wait, and they want to buy things immediately. So it's great that for retailers to have these different platforms like social media, or, you know, like online websites, or like where they can literally just be like, you can buy this now and you don't have to wait for it. And also, when you look at brands like Zara, which is such a massive brand on the high street now, they can literally turn an item around in like 3 weeks. It's insane.
Yes.
So they can think on a catwalk, which that trend would probably take like a whole 6 months to have made its way down to the grassroots level beforehand. And now it will be in shoppers' hands in 3 weeks.
Yes.
So yeah. the speed of everything is sped up so much. And maybe that's why men are actually consuming more, because there's more option. There's more place for them to consume.
Yes. Yeah, I guess, you know, because, you know, there's, you know, habit to shop online for men. I mean, it's I guess as well, because it's just so ridiculously straightforward, isn't it? I mean, now you can just, I mean, I could go right now, for example, I could go on, I don't know, Amazon or something and order something, and I can actually even get, you know, same day delivery, not even next day delivery. It's just so fast, as you're saying.
Oh my God, it's so fast. Like, when you think about Net-a-Porter, Mr. Porter, and even ASOS are doing it now in London, you can get, you can order something at like 10 o'clock and it'd be with you in 2.2 minutes.
It's crazy. It's mad, isn't it? I think that's the kind of thing that people, you know, let's say someone 50 years ago, just wouldn't think that was possible. I don't think. It's crazy.
No, I mean, I didn't think it was possible like 10 years ago.
Exactly.
When everyone thought bloggers would be over by now. And they're still there.
Yeah, still kicking around.
100%.
Well, Josh, thank you very much indeed for your time today. Thanks for chatting to us. I'm just going to ask you, actually, if there's anything else that you'd like to add. Also, I think you mentioned that you can check out this survey, actually. So if anyone did want to do that, you can head to Barclaycard's site, right?
Yeah, if you head to Barclaycard.com, you can check out all the findings. And it does make for really interesting reading, even if it's just a debate with your partner, whether you actually spend more than they do. Because I feel like that's quite a good little debate to get into.
Yeah, the battle's on.
That the ladies aren't as big a spenders as the guys thought they were.
Yeah, well, there we go. I mean, the battle's on, I think. And maybe we should treat this as a competition. Let's do another survey.
Game on. Battle of the sexes. Take two.
That's it. Well, Josh, thank you very much indeed. Really appreciate you coming on the show. That's hashtag goal, actually. Interviewed you, got you on the show. Hashtag goals.
Oh, that is super flattering. I would have that to the top of my CV. I'm hashtag interview goals.
That's it.
Love
that's
that. It. That's going in my Instagram bio, because obviously we're all about being a modern man.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
100%.
Well, cheers, Josh. Thanks very much. Really
no
appreciate
worries.
That.
Have a great day.
Thanks, you too. Thanks.
Bye.
Yeah, cheers again, Josh. Fantastic to have on the show. Josh Newis-Smith there, celeb interviewer, as well as you know, his other roles as the celeb and fashion director over at InStyle. Fantastic to have on the show. Fashion expert. Thank you to you. Thank you to all of our other special guests as well. In particular, thanks to Lizzie Carr, Dr. Petra Simic, the fabulous Baker Bros. Thank you all. And thank you. Now, here's the biggest thank you to you. Yes, you. I'm addressing you. Yeah, don't look around. I'm talking to you. Yeah, you listening? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in. Coming towards the end of the show now, there's just actually a couple of points. A couple of points I want to make to finish up. And also, I've got a cracking request. Just come through from Bian. Going to get that on, obviously. Thank you for that, Bian. We'll certainly play that very shortly indeed. That point about the Amazon delivery now. I'm gonna leave this physicist anonymous, okay? Just in case the story actually was a bit too true, you know. He was joking saying this, but if he wasn't, then, you know, wouldn't want to embarrass him. But he said the best thing about this Amazon same day delivery, so you can now apparently get this it's basically a little dot thing which you stick on your fridge or somewhere like this, and you basically you know, it keeps track of what you need, what you're running low on, and it automatically adds it to your shopping cart and buys it for you. Some Amazon technology. But he said you should have one. Well, should I really say this? But yeah, okay. So he said he wanted one for the loos, because when he runs out of loo roll, he can just say loo roll, please, and then it just, like, a drone arrives or something, and he did a great little impression of running down the stairs actually to fetch the loo roll that just arrived on the same day delivery. So there you are, Amazon, if you're listening. Get on it. Yeah. Loo roll specific deliveries. Maybe that could be more urgent. Maybe that can be next minute delivery. Same minute delivery. That'd be good, wouldn't it? Okay, enough of that madness. And I'm pleased as well, we could talk about fashion for men and women there with Josh, because, you know, it makes me really sad. And this crops up all over the place. You know, and we've kind of, you know, spoken about this before, you know, with particularly vital when it comes to things like science and STEM. But it just makes me really sad, and I think it makes everybody really sad. So, you know, this is something which everybody, you know, should be aware of, should be more aware of. You know, I think it always does good to talk about it. And that is, of course, people feeling like they're less able, you know, not able or less able to do a particular thing, whatever it is. You know, and I'm talking right the way from, you know, vital things like applying to STEM, you know, right the way through to, you know, fashion choices and spending, you know, all of this stuff. And that is, you know, when people feel like they're less able to do something just because of their gender. So, you know, we've addressed this before. We've addressed STEM before in particular, because STEM, obviously coming from a science background myself, you know, as over here at the Cornwall Science Sessions,
This is a big issue close to our hearts in STEM, but it applies everywhere, doesn't it? So, you know, it goes for everything, really. Never feel like you can't do something just because of your gender, basically. Makes no sense, does it? Let's change this, you know. Come on, people, modern. I'm not talking to you. I mean, all of us know this, right? You know, I'm sure you're in agreement there, listening in. So thank you very much for listening. Now, here we go then, this request. Now, Bianne, comment goes with this song choice, actually. Well, it's called Ray of Light, okay? Bit of Madonna for you now. Now, she says it's a shame it's not Ray of Polarized Light, because that would have gone great with that previous section just before Josh there, your secret sense. Polarization vision. Google Haidinger's brush. If you missed that, just Google Haidinger's brush. Yeah, don't worry about the spelling for Haidinger. Just pop in what you think it is, and yeah, I'm sure you'll find it. Yeah, and just look that up and teach yourself to see polarized light if you miss the explanation, or catch the show on catch up. You know, that could be even better. Hey, anyway, yeah, let's get this on for you. Bianne, this is for you. Thanks for texting me, and thank you as always for your fantastic choices. Just perfect.
Quicker than
Well, that's it, folks. I'm so sorry. It's time for me to say goodbye. Thank you very much for joining me. Thank you very much to all of our special guests as well. Hope you enjoyed the show. Catch me next time, Thursday morning. Cornwall Science Sessions, but don't be shy and don't be scared. You know, we don't just cover science. You know, branched out from that. You know, don't be frightened. You know, experts from all over the place. You know, today branched out into fashion, into cooking. I like branching out into cooking. Cooking's fantastic. If only I was a better cook. Yeah, you might have caught some of my cooking skills earlier in the show, and they're probably not to be repeated. Actually, just thinking about it, maybe this show won't be on catch up because I probably better delete the evidence for that one. Anyway, moving swiftly on, I shall say my goodbye. Thanks for tuning in. Hope you have an absolutely fantastic day. Coming at next, DJ Steve, so don't go anywhere. Here on the Source FM, we're with you all day, obviously. Thank you for joining me. Now, I'm going to leave you, actually. Well, I had a great plan, okay? So I just suddenly thought, all right, well, actually, that's not very fair because Josh didn't get his theme tune. Josh didn't actually choose his theme tune. I've chosen one for him. I'm going to play that next. And then I thought, yeah, I just suddenly remembered, oh, now this is a good song, isn't it? I'm not going to tell you what it is. That's coming up straight after this, okay? Actually, that bit of Madonna there reminded me of this song. So, yeah, just listen very, very close. I thought, obviously, we're going to have some Rod Stewart. Popped him in there. Now, you know, maybe, just maybe, I'll get away with this, okay? I've queued up quite a lot of Rod Stewart songs, actually. I don't know, we'll see. DJ Steve might pop in and say, oh, you know, actually, you know what? My work's done for me, Rod, that'll do. Just leave it on. We'll see. Maybe. Or maybe he'll do his show. I don't know. Can't promise anything. Right, okay. Let's get this on for you now then. Oh, this is good.